the model that I used was a fellow that I met in Yellowstone in the first summer that I met there. And that was Harry Reynolds. I met him on the steps of the superintendent's office when I first went into Yellowstone in 1947. The man liked it, broke my hand when I shook hands with him. And I said, I never will again will I shake a hand with anybody. And they're going to break my hand. I'll, well, you know, I wasn't going to break their hands, but by golly, I wasn't going to be like a dead fish in their hand.
I would probably say the greatest symbol was that hat. getting that hat, that Ranger hat, that was a big thing, because now you felt like, I felt like I was part of the tradition, that there was a lineage to that, and I had a responsibility to carry on the lineage.
The fact that I was not in uniform, I think, made it a lot harder for me. Because people, if they thought that I was an engineer, they treated me like an engineer. And if they thought that I was an engineer, they thought I might be thinking too much about our rehabilitation from an engineering standpoint rather than an environmental or a design standpoint. When people see me that don't know me, they automatically smile. And that's a good feeling, to already have a good relationship with somebody before you even say any words. I think people respect the National Park Service, and I think that they love the National Park Service. So when they see somebody wearing the uniform, I think most people welcome it.
The dual image can sometimes be confusing. I think that any uniform, especially a uniform with a badge, is always going to carry some level of authority, regardless. I think people want to know their parks are protected. I think they probably wish there wasn't crime in parks, but I think they're realistic enough to know that there is. And if we weren't available to do what needs to be done, whether it's anything from putting a sign up to making an arrest, I think the American public would think we were being irresponsible.
No one even thinks about, you know, men or women or the differences in the jobs. It's just like getting the work done and being the best ranger you can be, whatever your sex is. In the book, they speak to women park rangers or naturalists not being allowed to wear, or being required to wear a different uniform than a male ranger, and not necessarily being able to wear the full Park Service arrowhead, you know, logo, that their uniforms were much more feminine and not nearly as distinctive as people think of as a traditional ranger.
The ranger over there on the horse, look, he's got a big, I can't remember what that's called, that nightstick with the T-shaped nightstick, and he looks like he's packing a 9mm on his hip. Does that bother anybody when they go to a national park or any kind of a park area and see a ranger, be it a city ranger, state ranger, national park ranger, with a gun and a uniform and mirrored sunglasses? And an intimidating posture. Does that bother you when you're at a park? Because it sure as heck bothers a lot of people in the National Park Service. That image is not what the National Park Service is about, folks.
When you look at it from a law enforcement perspective, what's different in managing a park than, say, being a city police officer is if you're a city police officer and you get a call to a burglary, you go to Fred's electronics store or Nancy's computer store, and you may or may not arrest somebody for stealing Nancy's computer. But even if you don't, you know, it's not your computer, it was Nancy's. In park protection, every crime is like it happened in your house. And you have such a different perspective because it's your park. You'll hear park employees call it my park. Because that's where they work. And so all the crimes are committed on their property, it's a personal crime almost.
I would use the lowest level of enforcement necessary to get the job done. And sometimes I was criticized because I wasn't hardcore enough. I didn't take somebody and haul them to jail. Taking them to jail wouldn't have done any good.
There's always been that Boy Scout context to somewhat to Ranger work as well. I disagree with that image.
How so?
Because I think it's too simplistic. Park work is not something you can just pick up tomorrow and do. You know, during the government shutdown last year, there was this clamoring in some quarters that the National Guard could go in and run X park. I think that's a mistakenly oversimplistic perspective on what park management is, especially in this day and age, which is a complex interrelationship of people and land and human and cultural and resources. And the Boy Scout image, I think, is reduces the ranger, or actually the park professional in general, not just rangers, but any park professional, to that kind of we're just here to do good instead of we're here to manage in a responsible, professional manner. We have an image of protecting these large natural areas, but in reality, we have as strong a responsibility for the history of the United States as evidenced in the smaller historical parks. And the Boy Scout image really doesn't fall in there at all. So it does a disservice to almost 2/3 of the system.
And you've become an interpretive park ranger, which has its own profession within the
right.
National Park Service. So what distinguishes that from being one of those other kinds of rangers?
Well, you're called a fern feeler, a yogurt sucker, because, you know, you're different than them. You don't carry a gun. You know, it's not as macho. Unfortunately, a lot of superintendents look at interpretation as something nice to do, a little frosting on the cake, you know, a little fluff.
Well, in those days, you had to, the normal progression for a ranger was to start, or to a superintendent or even to a regional director, was to have started out as a ranger, and you became a district ranger, and then assistant chief ranger, finally a chief ranger, eventually to a superintendent, and a few superintendents would get in to be a regional director.
Superintendent for Yosemite or Yellowstone or Grand Canyon, they're in effect like governors. I mean, if you really think about the acreage that they are responsible for, larger than some states.
Mm-hmm. And they have their responsibility for everything. It goes on. I mean, it's law enforcement, it's interpretation, it's maintenance, and it's in the administration. So in effect, that's right, they are the governor. In fact, it was a term that was coined by the former director, Connie Wirth, who said they were the captain of their ship. Which was true, but it also made some problems for the regional director and even for the director. Because as a captain of a ship, that's true, they were. But the thing that many of them forgot was that they were also a part of a task force. And that is, if you looked at Navy terms, because the task force had a responsibility and the Park Service has a responsibility. But every ship has to be in a certain position and a certain location within their task force. But some superintendents would feel, well, I'm the captain of my ship, and that means I don't have any responsibility to you. Not very many of them, but occasionally that would happen.
And then the other cultural thing was about there was this aversion to strange people, like hippies. They were different, you know. They weren't clean cut. Our class was really weird because we had five women in our class, which was only the second intake training class that had women in it. And boy, that really bothered Wayne Cohen and a couple of the other instructors and some of the other people that, you know, here women were going to be rangers. This is a man's job. Can't be done by women. So what do we have now? 40% of all rangers are women. So it's a great career. There's been a lot of changes in that almost 30 years.
those photographs, I think, are pretty telling. They're from Mount Rainier, and they speak to activity that was going on in the very beginning of the park, the CCC era. A lot of the construction work that went on in the parks was, obviously male craftsmen building roads, bridges, and doing beautiful work in the parks. And the planning teams, the design work were predominantly men as well. And the role of women in the Park Service was as Park Service wives or support groups to the parks.
The architect that I worked with was a woman. She was about 30, a young professional. And there were occasions where we would go out to the park. She was in, I was in the division of maintenance, so there was a lot of times where we had to go out and to actually talk to the people in the park and the maintenance supervisors and whatnot. And sometimes the people that we talked to were surprised that it was two women, or if our boss went along, two women and a man, and that the woman, my friend Wendy, that she was in charge of the project and that she was the one that was going to be doing it.
Kind of in terms of the ethic, what's your perception of concessionaires? I know you've worked in Yellowstone also in an association with other concessionaires. What's generally the ethic that the concessionaire organization would have in a park compared to the ethic that people in the National Park Service have about stewardship for the resources and why they're there and how they relate to the visiting public and how they provide a service to them? Do you find a congruency there in those attitudes?
I think, I was thinking I may surprise you with my answer, but I think that the concessionaires understand. I think it's evolving. Let me say that first of all. I think the attitude of a concessionaire in 1930 is vastly different than the attitude of a concessionaire in 1997. I think they very much understand that they cannot be consumers in any way, shape, or form of that resource. What their activities have to be very respectful of the resource, because the reason that people are coming, staying in their hotel rooms, shopping in their gift shops, riding the horses through the backcountry, dining, in the evening, or taking a boat out to fish on Lake Yellowstone, whatever the case may be, is because of the character of that resource, the pristine nature of that resource to the greatest extent possible. So I think through a lot of education, through a lot of change in attitude by the American public, by the concessionaires, I think they are stewards in many ways of the resources that we have as well. But I think the battles, if you want to call them battles, that we fight are what are those appropriate activities? Because we dictate, we the National Park Service say, these are the activities that we believe need to be provided for the visiting public. We will give you an opportunity to make a fair profit, for providing those activities. Will you provide them? And we've been very successful in getting people to provide those activities or those services within national parks. If you use Mount Rushmore as an example, during the height of the summer season, we may have 25,000 visitors a day. At maximum, I'll have 60 employees. The concessionaire will have 160 employees. In Yellowstone, the National Park Service may have 1,000 or 1,200 employees, and the concessionaire has 3,000 employees at Yellowstone. So, it's they do have that opportunity, and they see them in a more of an informal session or a more informal relationship oftentimes. Often when they see us, it's part of a specific program activity. When they see a concession employee, it's when they're having dinner and planning their next day's activities, or they're involved in an activity. It might be a horseback ride through the backcountry of Yellowstone, or whatever that case may be.
And putting that modern air conditioning system in that historic building might diminish and damage it such and change it. It's what I would call change by accretion. All of these small little changes of the security system alarms you start to put up, the thermostats you put up, the plugs, the switches, the security lights, that over a period of time buildings change.
When I was in Yellowstone National Park, I was there the late 70s and early 80s. My generation, if you will, the baby boom generation, was obviously much younger. They were hiking, they were backcountry, you know, they were using the backcountry. That was a big push at the time. We've gotten older. My generation has more money. That was their use of the parks at then. Now, you know, the most expensive hotel rooms in those parks sell out probably the quickest. Their expectations change with their personal situation, with their number of children they maybe have with them in the car, and what they can and can't do. Instead of taking that week-long backcountry hike through Yellowstone, you know, they may be staying in a nice hotel and taking day hikes with their children. Not a less experience, you know. I mean, I think it's probably a wonderful experience, because when they were kids, they probably never went to the great Western National Parks in many cases and had that opportunity to do those things. I think, how's it changing? I think the expectations are what's changing most dramatically. Everything's different about our environment, and I'm not talking inside, I'm talking outside the national park system, in terms of the information age, if you will, and the kind of technology that people are exposed to on a daily basis, whether it be in school or whether it be in the workplace or whether it be in terms of entertainment. When they come to the national parks, they are in many cases vignettes of time. We work very hard to preserve natural ecosystems, cultural resources in a certain context of history. And so they are pieces of time in many places, or pieces of resource that we hope to preserve. But there's still a demand, I think, by the American public to make those things relevant to them today. And I think we're starting to catch up with that a little bit, but I'm sure we're not there yet. In terms of, you know, how do we interpret that resource, whether it be a historic resource, a cultural resource, or a great natural resource, how do we interpret it? How do we make, whether they be senior citizens or whether they be the young people, how do we, you know, do it so that everybody can take away something in terms of education or knowledge about what they've experienced? And we're starting to deal with that, I think, a little bit better.
Do you see a change in the ethnicity of the visitor that comes to national parks? Do you see what you would think might be more urban visitors, or do you see more foreign tourists? You know, we hear that there's more tour packages being offered. Just in terms of that, maybe a little more specific, the people that come to the park.
We've surveyed our visitors for the demographics in terms of age, in terms of point of origin, you know, et cetera. And without a doubt, I would tell you, we have 2.6 million visitors. Certainly probably a couple hundred thousand of those every year are foreign visitors. Our primary foreign visitor comes from Germany in Europe. Our secondary is the Pacific Rim. And I think that's one of the exciting things about trying to deal with the visitors at Mount Rushmore, is that you're dealing with their life histories, you know, their frame of reference for what America means. Immigrants to this country, Mount Rushmore has a, you know, they come up, they have naturalization services at Mount Rushmore every few years to naturalize new American citizens. I mean, they come to Mount Rushmore and they're almost overwhelmed. It's amazing when something is fought for, whether it be through a battle on a field someplace, and whether it be a foreign country or our country, or whether it's fought for by learning about our country because you want to become a citizen, the meaning is different than for those who haven't.
Well, let's take a minute and go through a series of slides here will represent some of that diversity in terms, I think, also in terms of scale of structures and such. And our next two slides are actually of a place that I think we've both been to, and that's Ellis Island, which has a tremendous history for this country and means an awfully lot to many, many people and their ancestors.
Yes, it does. And interestingly enough, I think Ellis Island is, again, one of those success stories that a generation ago, Ellis Island was abandoned. It was heavily vandalized. Still, portions of Ellis Island are still in a very derelict state now. But the popularity, again, going back to, does the public have a perception when want to visit sites like this? Absolutely, yes, they do. To such an extent that a side effect of that popularity of Ellis Island is now New York State and New Jersey have been in a have had a lengthy battle over where does Ellis Island belong and in whose jurisdiction. Not all the stories that are told at Ellis Island are comfortable stories. They aren't. They tell us about where we've been. Certainly, to hear the stories of immigrants who were quarantined, of those who were sent back, of how they were treated when they give me, you're hungry, you're tired, you're weak, how we actually treated people, those themes need to be told. We tell them also at Kalapapa National Historic Site, where Hansen's disease, leprosy, was treated in Hawaii. A site recently legislated in the West Coast was where the internment camps for the Japanese. Those stories and those sites present entire new challenges to us, and they are not always comfortable stories, but they're authentic stories, and they certainly tell us about what it takes to maintain a democracy.
A directive saying, under the requirements of, I think it's the National Performance Review, we're supposed to have customer services for everything we do, the whole federal government is, and customer standards. And we got a note from somebody that said, here's the 5 or 6 customer standards that we are thinking of adopting, that the customer will be satisfied when this happens. And I looked at it and I said, "Now this is exactly the kind of thing that makes people think the government is arrogant. We're telling the public when they're going to be satisfied. We've decided when they're going to be satisfied. Here it is." Well, no private company, I mean, no retail company is going to say, "Yeah, you will be satisfied." It's the old Ford attitude, you know, you can have any color car as long as it's black, and you'll like it. You know, it's as if some, you know, Sears said, you know, "We have one kind of wrench, you'll like that. You don't need different size wrenches. It's not our problem." And we're essentially doing that instead of going to the public and say, "When would you be satisfied? You tell us what it is that when you walk into a park, if it's there or not there, you'll think it's appropriate." That's what we should be doing.
Harpers Ferry is
it's in Virginia.
Yeah, West Virginia, and it's right at the confluences of the Shenandoah and Potomac River. So it's up high, and it's got a beautiful view of the surrounding two states, which is Maryland and Virginia, and it's got good views of the river. And in fact, it floods quite often. But the problem with it was that people not only came to see this historic town. They came to get close to the river. And what that did was provide too many visitors with cars that take over every piece of parking space in the town. It got to such a point that we had to do something. I mean, there was just more and more people wanted to come see Harpers Ferry and visit the river. And there was only one alternative, is that not to allow cars in. And what they did is build a parking, I would say 800 parking lot out in 2 miles away. And they build a visitor contact facility and a shuttle system. So when people come to the park, they've got to actually drive, in most cases, by the park to this parking area, which aggravates people. But once they get on the bus, they realize that just the bus ride itself is enjoyable. Because it's going through some nice terrain, and once they get down in the town, they realize that they don't have to look both ways before they cross the street because cars aren't allowed.
You
not many people really associate national park units with parkways in urban areas. Now, you've worked in parkways as well as more rural settings in the East Coast. What are some of your perceptions? How do you, what do you see as some of the differences between them?
I think the biggest difference is that in urban areas, there's more and more homes going up and more buildings, and there's less and less open space. And because of that, we're getting more people using our national parks for different purposes. And to give you an example, if we have a vacant piece of land that's out there just to be natural, people want us to put grass in there and put ball fields in. On the Washington Monument grounds itself, there are some steep slopes. The monument is on a large hill in the middle of D.C. And during the summer, I counted, I think it was 31 softball games going on.
Here's this platform, if you want to call it that, of green grass at the base of the monument, where you have international and national visitors lining up, and you've got 31 softball games going on. Does anyone ever say, maybe we ought to go out and chase those people away?
Yeah, that's, we've thought of that.
As you spoke about the meaning of the resource at Mount Rushmore, some of the things you were saying and how you said it evoked a response and emotion in me that I had when I visited also monuments, memorials in Washington, D.C. and other places in our country. Is there a connection in terms of the role of a Mount Rushmore in a system of parks? Is there an obvious connection in your mind to what you do at Mount Rushmore and also in complementary to what happens with maybe those same visitors when they go to Washington, D.C. or a battlefield, one of the battlefield parks in the system?
Absolutely, there's a connection. Are we maximizing that connection right now? No, we're not. We're not talking about oftentimes we're not talking about the interrelationships between, or we're not, I can't tell you, for example, you know, what the program is at the Jefferson Memorial or the Lincoln Memorial or Washington Monument in terms of how they deal with that. Something, should I know it? Absolutely, I should.
Acadia during the summer months is a little like being in an urban park. Acadia is so beautiful, and the summer months are so short, the nice months, that visitors are just jammed in. They're thinking about coming up with some type of transportation system and not allowing cars in. There's a loop road that goes around Acadia, and the cars are just jammed up in the, it's like an urban park.
That every threat to a park resource, by our definition, by the Park Service definition, is a human threat. Because by our definition, if it's a natural process, it's not a threat.
Years and years ago, actually, let me try to separate. There's three smaller bindings within this case here. And many years ago, there were actually separate policies, one for recreation areas. It was called the Blue Book. And then there was another for natural areas, the Green Book, and another set of policies for historical areas.
Mm-hmm.
And these were all packaged up in this wonderful yellow box. For Park Service superintendents and others to make decisions. And over the years, how policies are used have changed a lot. I know at one point I'd heard even that some policies, a director had thrown them out. You said that you knew of cases where
Ranger might go 25 feet.
25 feet of rules and regs and tips on how to manage your park. More recently now, the National Park Service has management policies that are bound in a three-ring binder like mm-hmm. this, and essentially those are, you can take them out of the binder, you don't have to have the binder, but they're, they're paper, and there are actually 10 sections here that cover everything from visitor use to park development, as this one says, wilderness preservation and management. There's one specifically on concessionaires, there's one on interpretation, there's one mm-hmm. on natural resource management, cultural resource management. And it's kind of interesting because to think you could manage an entire national park system and all its diversity with actually a fairly small set of guidelines. How did those work for you? Were they helpful, and what's your feeling about policy statements and the interpretation of those on a day-to-day basis?
Well, it goes back even back in 1947 when I was a seasonal ranger. I remember there was only one thing that a ranger had any responsibility for. It was a policy that was written out in the policies that we had at that time that the only thing that a ranger could do was to tell an individual, or not tell an individual, but he could respond. If a person was camping, he could alter his campsite somewhat, and he could move some of the soil in it. That was the only thing that a park ranger could do. That was a policy.
The only thing the ranger could do.
Well, that was the only thing that you could do that you had any responsibility yourself for, you see. Everything else was written out for you. Well, when George Hartzog was a director, he said, by golly, I'm going to change this outfit. I'm going to make it more creative. I'm going to eliminate that 25-foot bookcase of policies or guidelines that were used. He was going to throw them out. And of course, at that time, George made quite a statement to not only to the Park Service, but he made it to government as a whole. You know, by golly, we're going to start making the employee of the Park Service, or make the employee of the government, more creative, and he's going to do things on his own. But it meant that you had to have somebody who knew what the policies were, because a policy is nothing but an interpretation of what the law is, and Congress had made the laws. So somebody has to interpret that, and you have to be sure then that everybody's going to carry those things out, and that was the reason for the book.
So you have the policies interpret the law.
That's right.
And then in effect, on a day-to-day basis, a park superintendent then does their own interpretation of, in fact, the policies.
But he has to make that interpretation within the confines of what the limitations to the policy are. So in other words, there's no hunting in national parks. That was true in the Green Book. It's true in the Blue Book.
The more recent policies in the large blue binder are modified, as policies are revised occasionally, and they say no hunting, but with the Alaska Lands Act and subsistence, you get the law involved again that states we will allow hunting for subsistence in certain areas. So the policies get modified to say there's no hunting, however, or except when it's authorized by law. So it's not a blank statement. You have to understand
right.
the other legislation that relates to a particular park.
Well, and there isn't anything in here but doesn't go back to the Constitution of the United States. I mean, when we look at it, that is what the policy is based on, the law, which is based on the Constitution. So in effect, what it's saying, when you're saying that you can't shoot the elk in Yellowstone, that's the policy. But that relates to a law, and the law could be changed. If the law will then be in conformance to the Constitution, you could essentially come to the time and you could have hunting in Yellowstone.
You know, we do have to make sure that those resources are there, you know, as the mandate says, for future generations. And it's important to, in the policymaking, to consider all of the options. And I think as the park staff becomes more diverse in backgrounds, Hopefully that will reflect the visitors, and so that the decisions that are made will be the decisions that the visitors like to see and reflect what they are doing in the park. And hopefully the visitor will come full circle. They will want the things that are good for the park, and the park will want things that are good for the visitor.
The facility that occupied the preeminent location at the mountain, the best view of the mountain, the best place to see it, we knew that you had to buy a hamburger before you could sit in that dining room to get that view. We didn't think that was right. We thought that that should be available to everybody.
The most controversial policy statements is the one about development in parks. And I like to ask my class whether concessions facilities are authorized to be built in national parks. And obviously, most people's contact is that, sure, they're all over national parks. When in fact, the policies say they are offered outside the park or can be offered outside the park, nothing will be built in the park. And in fact, we will remove facilities that are duplicates of what's offered nearby.
But once it's been built inside, it's going to be like pulling teeth to move it outside. There was a time when we would have said, we will put out every fire by 10 o'clock the next morning, because that's the time when the fires are burning the worst. At 10 a.m. until 3 p.m., that's your worst burning period. Every fire is to be controlled by 10 o'clock the next morning. And today, you won't even see that in a policy, because we're saying that the fire is, unless the fire is going to endanger human life, or it's going to endanger what man has placed there. But you see, in a park, we're saying now even that you're saying that some of those developments that we have in the park aren't even supposed to be there. We would move them out. So maybe even we might even say that some fires might be burning and could even take out a development. Would we put it back? And today Yellowstone or Yosemite is being questioned on the basis of the natural phenomena that occurred there last week, or well, a couple weeks ago now. That is the rain and the mudslides, and it took out the water system, and it took out the connections for their sewer system, and it caused a number of their cabins to be washed out. The question is being raised by some of the editorial writers: should the Park Service go back and build back as much as was there before, or is this an opportunity to reduce the level of impact that the valley has?
And certainly a structure so noteworthy that extreme efforts were successfully made to save it during the 1988 fires, and it still sits there as a wonderful example of architectural historic preservation.
A wonderful example of a legacy of park architecture, as opposed to the earlier Nez Perce example of and a national historic landmark. That building, the Old Faithful Lodge, has withstood the test of time. It is a very significant piece of rustic architecture in and of its own right. That it is right adjacent to Old Faithful was intended. I think the American public would rightfully raise an uproar if we said we wanted to restore the Old Faithful site to the point when Samuel Coulter first went and encountered Yellowstone on his voyages through the West.
And I think the public would be supportive of that. A reservation system and setting use limits in the park, not only in the wilderness, but in the front country as well, in the developed areas. You know, there's only so much development that the park can take care of, the park can handle. And I would have to agree that use limits and a reservation system and addressing the issue of carrying capacities, that's what needs to be done.
in the way that it sets it up, the way that it is respectful of the memorial. But it doesn't, I don't think it tries to draw attention to itself. It, by the classic lines, it tries to really become a very much a secondary feature. The mountain is the primary focus.
I was only there for 2 years, and that second year there was broad expanses of the park up in the high elevations along the Skyline Drive, along the Appalachian Trail, that those trees were leafless. And boy, you know, people would come through there and they say, geez, the park is ruined. And one of the ways all of our staff treated that was that we would go back to when Shenandoah was established in 1930, whatever the year was, I don't remember offhand, 32 or 33. And at that time, it had been basically logged over and farmed. Much of the farming had turned the hillsides into bare soil, and the creeks were muddied. And as the park developed and the land was brought into the park, it was all purchased by the state of Virginia and then transferred to the National Park Service. Less than 50 years later, the majority of park, 90% of the park, 90+% of the park, was deemed wilderness, congressional wilderness area. So it responded by letting it grow back. It covered up all of the sins of man, basically.
What it really amounted to was that the concessioner was pushing for the most people that they could take down the river. I think there were about 17 different operators at one time on the Colorado River. And they were, most of them were taking down people who would go down on ore raft, that is motor rafts. And of course, every one of those people, I think it was the greatest experience they'd ever had. But to the person who went down in an ore raft after going down in a motor raft would say that the ore raft was the greatest experience. That is, the younger people would. And so the Park Service said, well, wait a minute, if we're going to really make the wilderness if we're really going to have wilderness in Grand Canyon, then we cannot have motors. And the initial idea was, well, the motors would pollute the water of the Colorado River. And so the idea was, okay, then we'll have a study made, we'll show that there is pollution in the river from the motors. But what it showed was that, by golly, there wasn't that much pollution occurring in the Colorado River because of the motor. It was really a question of whether or not this was a kind of typical use it should be in a national park. If you want to have an ore raft, you can go to Canyonlands National Park and run the Colorado River in the upper portions of the green, or you can get down on the Colorado River in a part of Canyonlands National Park. Or if you want to go down in only half a day, you can go to Grand Teton and run the Snake River, because we were running ore rafts there. But there was an ore, but you could go down in a half a day. So what we were saying is that the public, in terms of their experiences and the opportunity that they had to make a decision, wasn't going to be based solely or narrowly in Grand Canyon. It was going to be based on their options that they would have in a number of different areas within the system.
And when those standards first came out, I thought that they were a little vague. And then I was not involved in putting the standards together. Highway engineers from the Federal Highway Administration and Park Service landscape architects were involved. And I think a couple superintendents were involved also from an administrative standpoint. I think that they did a good job. I didn't understand why it was so vague, but after I talked to them and they explained it to me, I realized that they're standards, but they're also just guidelines. If there was a particular case where we came up above where these standards wouldn't fit, we would just throw them out the window and do whatever was right for that particular site. These were just, even though they're standards, they're more like guidelines to help us come up with good ideas without sacrificing safety.
Here's a situation in the Everglades where we needed to get some elevation and it needed to be accessible, and I think it's very gracefully done.
Observation platforms are an interesting sidelight of visitor experience to the National Park Service. I'll talk about two examples, one right near my home in Antietam National Battlefield. At Bloody Lane, there is a structure that was built, I think about 19, turn of the century, to allow returning veterans and visitors to that battlefield to get elevated up to get a good view of the battlefield. Our policies now, we would never build a structure like that in 1997, particularly right at Bloody Lane, right at that authentic place, that point where the armies of the North and South battled and thousands of men died in the single bloodiest day in American history in terms of battles.
The position that the park is in now is that if you come to climb the mountain and you want to do a solo ascent, then they can turn you down if they don't feel that you're, you know, have the ability to be up there by yourself. But technically, you can't get turned down to climb the mountain unless you don't have enough equipment or unless you don't pass the ranger's general little skill test about what would you do in this condition and what would you do in that condition. And so it leads to sometimes people up there who don't have the skills to be climbing the mountain. And so that the rangers are trying to figure out a way to kind of filter through that. And that's something that we're dealing with in terms of wilderness. And the other thing is the number of people up there.
The park superintendent is really a very key person, because that park superintendent at any time can rely on policy and change a regulation. And for instance, fishing may be allowed in a lake in a park. If that superintendent feels there's a threat in any way to those resources, he can terminate that.
He can terminate it, but he if he's going to be smart, he's going to make sure that his regional director and the director, and then you're going to have some kind of a program that lets the public know what you're going to do before you do it. But it's true. It's true. He can. But he initiates it, but he doesn't finalize it until he's made sure that he's covered all the bases behind him, because he wants to be sure that if that policy is carried out, that he won't be rescinded.
General public across this nation encounter a wide variety of historic properties, resources, and being managed in lots of ways in different conditions. Do you have any perceptions about how the public views any inconsistencies in how we treat these?
Well, I would answer that question in two parts. And the first part would be, I think the American public expects from the National Park Service authentic places. I think that they expect authentic stories and real places with real events in this virtual world we live in today. I think that's even more important. However, the second expectation a family that visits one of our national parks may have is to actually see and visit a site and come away with a better understanding of whatever that site commemorates. And oftentimes the challenge is in many areas that Congress has set aside for protection is there may be nothing there. And so we're challenged with how do we tell a story of perhaps an event or act where there's no physical remains left and the public has an expectation. And so those are situations where, say, reconstructions may be asked for. And the public, I think, enjoys them, but they cause great dilemma to the policymakers in the cultural resource field.
It's right here on the map. It's, here's Olympic National Park, North Cascades, and Mount Rainier. So we get a lot of visitors from the Puget Sound area, the growing Seattle area. I've been in the park for a year now. and it certainly feels fantastic. I've always had a strong desire to get to the Northwest, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity to be there. And it's been a lot of what I expected and lots of what I didn't expect. I certainly had perceptions of the Northwest as big, lush, beautiful landscapes, and of course, a good deal of Mount Rainier is the mountain itself, the glacier, and that's kind of an interesting way to look at the park, as two parts in this one park. In the park's history, there's some readings that I've done and that are publications in the park that are available about John Muir climbing the summit of the mountain, and when the area was being considered for protection, Muir climbed to the summit and was just awestruck by the beauty. And there were those out there that said, well, just the mountain needs to be protected. And Muir came down and said that it's not the ice and the rocks that need to be protected. Well, that was fantastic. But it's the trees and the vegetation and the meadows and the subalpine meadows in the park. Those are the areas that need to be protected.
Some of these parkways were built in the 30s and 40s and 50s that they're on the National Register too, and it's our goal to keep them, the characteristic of that road, the same as it was when they first built it. And if they used stone walls when they first built the parkway, there'll always be stone walls there for barriers.
A construction project in the National Park Service is unlike any other construction project. It's not a typical construction site because we need to be sensitive to the resources, both natural and cultural, like these rock walls. And so a lot of our discussions have been, when we treat these rock walls, how should they be treated? The ones that we're leaving, some of them need to be repointed, meaning the mortar needs to be redone on some of them to give them that strength. And in some areas, we need to put in guard walls, the rock walls, where there weren't any before. And what do these new walls look like? How do you respect that historic fabric that's existing out there? But also, you don't want it to look like Disneyland. You don't want it to be fake, so people think that it's all CCC era. You don't want to give them, you want to be truthful about your work.
I think the Park Service has the most beautiful bridges in the country, and largely because they use stone in various ways. Acadia has probably the most beautiful bridges that I've ever seen, and each one was designed differently. Some of them have little cuts in the top of the parapet wall. It looked like a guy should be standing out there with a crossbow shooting somebody down below. It makes them feel that old and that special.
We have stonework along the edge of the highway that is was built during the CCC era, and Federal Highways wants to widen the road, and they want to make it safer because it's obviously a park road that was built a long time ago. And so we've been working back and forth with them to come up with a design standard for rock walls that will be compatible to the historic fabric that was built in the 30s, but with the struggles we faced were that the rock work that they did was, some of it is beautiful, and they've tested it and found that it's in great structural shape, and it's just as good as the day they built it. And some of it is not in great shape, and so some of those old walls need to be repointed, the mortar needs to be redone, and some need to be torn down, and or not torn down, but repointed, and some need to be extended to protect a farther edge of the road. And so we're working on some designs for new stone walls that will respect the fabric, but be cost effective, but not imitate it completely so someone would think that it's all from the same era. That they would know that it's new, but it's still, a seamless flow in the design.
Are some of the standards actually focused at trying to maintain a preserve some part of history, heritage? Are there corridors and road structures that are significant resources in themselves?
Absolutely. The Mount Vernon Memorial Highway, which you know, I spoke earlier, that goes from Memorial Bridge all the way down to Mount Vernon. That's on the National Register. And that road was built strictly to get to Mount Vernon. And that road will never be changed.
If I can start out with the primary purpose, I almost said secondary, but the primary purpose is none of the stuff at the bottom of the mountain would be necessary in terms of visitor use and enjoyment if that resource isn't protected. And we have a slide up now, I believe, at George Washington that has a series of survey dots that were all across the faces. And what they represent is really the first attempt by the National Park Service to get the baseline data that we need on the memorial to determine the structural stability of the mountain itself. In other words, we through a system of photographs, through computer modeling, we hired a geotechnical engineering firm, and what they have done is they've mapped the mountain intensively. They've then mapped all the cracks, all the faults that are in the mountain, projected those cracks into how many rock blocks are formed at Mount Rushmore, and what the interdependence of those rock blocks is one to the other for support. An interesting thing about Mount Rushmore, when people see it, they don't realize, and there's no real reason there should, but that design of that mountain changed 9 times over the course of the carving. It was not a stable piece of rock. For example, Lincoln started out on the opposite side of Washington, and they had to remove the Lincoln figure because the rock was not suitable to carve and it would have failed. Roosevelt was never part of the original design. If you look at Jefferson and the overall design, his head had to be tilted back because there was a crack that ran through his nose, and without tilting his head back, a portion of the nose would have fallen off before the rest of the mountain would have, well, it still would have been very apparent. So all those things are very important. It's a primary purpose that we're at Mount Rushmore, and we're taking care of those issues.
Very appropriate quote at this moment in our conversation, I believe. Do they truly add to the beauty?
Well, that's an unfair question to ask an architect when you talk about some of our structures at our cultural sites, our national historic sites. Absolutely, at the sites that celebrate great American architecture. The structure is the reason for the park.
I thought I heard you say something, suggested that sometimes there's money appropriated in good faith to care for a historic structure. And in fact, that may be the kiss of death to that fabric of that historic structure. Did I hear you correctly on that?
Well, I have to be very careful when I talk about the work we do on historic structures as a practitioner of the trade of attempting to improve a structure, make it safe, make it accessible, meet modern codes, sometimes the end result of all of that work in some of our structures is we've made a new building out of an old building. And that's when it becomes very difficult for the visitor to come expecting an authentic place and an authentic experience for our interpreters to say, well, this was the place, but really it dates to 1985 or 1988 because we've done all of this work.
This is a piece of work that I know you're familiar with.
Franklin Court in Philadelphia, designed by Ken Venturi. Yeah, very well-known site. in a very popular Independence National Historic Site, and I think was a very appropriate solution to giving the visitor information about a building that was missing. And again, I think that structure has now begun to stand that test of time. I don't think we regret having erected it. I think it is very clear to the visitor what it represents without incurring the cost of a reconstruction, and a reconstruction that we probably knew very little about enough of the detail to rebuild that building without vast amounts of conjecture. And I think the American public deserves better than conjecture from the National Park Service. They deserve authentic places and authentic experiences, the best that we can deliver.
These four are four of the newest parks created in the last 3 to 5 years. But they're unique. They're kind of the new wave of parks in that they're partnership parks. We don't own very much land. We're not going to own much land. It's not like Yellowstone where there's a, you know, this boundary around 1 million acres. Keweenaw is a collection of relics of the copper mining in the Keweenaw Peninsula of Michigan. This one looks like an old generic schoolhouse, you know, 1950s schoolhouse. This is the Monroe School in Topeka, Kansas. Anybody know what that refers to? Or what? Brown versus Board of Education. Hey, you guys are good. Thank you. Brown versus Board of Education. That is one of the newest National Park Service sites. We actually own that school. We're not interpreting that school. We're interpreting the Supreme Court decision of Brown versus Board. And that's a real challenge. That's a real challenge. And it's going to be a really exciting park. I was involved with the interpretive planning on that park, and it's a really exciting story. This one is Dayton Aviation Heritage National Historic Park in Dayton, Ohio. Again, we own that building because somebody gave it to us. We own the building next to it because they gave it to us, and we own the land in between because they gave it to us. It's the only land we own in that park. And by the Act, we have a partnership with Wright-Patterson Air Force Base at the Huffman Prairie Flying Field, where the Wright brothers learned how to fly their plane. We have a partnership with Carillon Park Historical Park, which is a private, like, museum park, where the Wright Flyer III is housed in a building that was designed by Orville Wright to show off the techniques of flight. And the third site is the Paul Lawrence Dunbar Home Historic Site. Does anybody know who Paul Lawrence Dunbar is, his relationship to flight and Wright brothers? See, you guys are a white audience. Paul Lawrence Dunbar is a very, very famous and important black poet, literary genius, who lived, he went to high school with Orville Wright, lived in the same neighborhood they did. The Wright brothers, you know, before they built airplanes, they made bicycles and did printing. They printed some of Dunbar's early works, so there was a relationship. They graduated the same class, so they're sort of related, interrelated stories, and we had really, really had to continually remind ourselves that Dunbar is part of the story of Dayton Aviation. It has nothing to do with the flight story, but it's part of that, and we kept talking about the Wright brothers in flight, and they kept reminding us that Paul Lawrence Dunbar is part of the story, and so we had to incorporate that into that. But it's a partnership park. This, anybody recognize that beautiful skyline of downtown Minneapolis? This is the Mississippi National River and Recreation Area, which is 79 miles of Mississippi River between Anoka County and another county south of St. Paul. But anyway, the river through the Twin Cities of St. Paul, Minneapolis. Again, the only land that we own are spoil islands that were created by the Corps of Engineers, dredge spoil, really class land. But there's 78 communities, 35 different entities that we are in partnership in operating this park. a really new challenge for interpretation and for park managers. So something to think about.
I mean, there seems to be a wide spectrum of from just stabilizing a historic structure and someone deciding that's all we're going to spend versus going to an elaborate kind of recreation.
Well, that certainly is a challenge for the Park Service now and the people that deal with our existing budgets and our existing needs of all the structures we have is that many individuals will go to a site such as Springfield, Illinois, which is a wonderful scene, terrific stories told about President Lincoln, and perhaps have that same expectation for another site in another state, and their legislators may also have that same expectation. We want to do something similar. And these things all involve a lot of capital investment. I think that sometimes we hold on a little too tight to our cultural heritage, and we want to preserve everything, and we just can't accept. And our policies don't allow a lot of leeway in this country for just accepting decay, and then liability and safety questions absolutely traumatize superintendents. And as a matter of fact, if we aren't going to restore something in the Park Service, oftentimes we'll knock it down, burn it, to make it so it isn't a hazard.
Even today, when we're almost at the realization of all the construction activities, I know I step back on occasion and say, did we do exactly the right thing? Certainly at the time when we were designing the facilities, I think we often, whether it be the National Park Service or the architects and engineers, the professional consultants that we hired, I think we often stepped back and said, you know, what kind of time frame are we designing here for? You know, what will this accomplish? Are we doing the right thing? What else should we have done? And I'm not saying that's unhealthy. I think it has to happen.
And we started in the middle and worked from both ends out because we wanted to gain expertise before we had to hit the very difficult areas. And there was one area in our design we wanted to keep completely free of new introduced structure, and this was right here. And this is where the mine went off that actually sunk the ship, and you could see where the big hole was. And much of the design of the surrounding plaza was driven by this in terms of wanting to represent symbolically the blast for the visitor, so that the visitor would get a sense of the explosion. And this level, this plane, is intended to be the water level of the ship, where the ship sat in water.
So our best intentions about being stewards for that historic fabric, historic structures, sometimes end up creating illusions to the public, even the visitor, about what's there and what's really a historic resource.
Or even worse, disappointments.
That suggests to me has something to do with beauty, perhaps, in our perceptions of what's acceptable and what's appropriate, and how we distinguish and make judgments, and how many people might not see things the same way about.
Oh, absolutely. And many of the newer sites we have in the National Park Service, we're facing these issues at the Presidio in San Francisco, at some of the other urban sites, Gateway National Recreation Area in New York, that had hundreds of military buildings, New River Gorge in West Virginia, where you have abandoned mining structures. They are not the perception that one would have of the historic president's house, Herbert Hoover's house, where President Hoover lived, and the challenges of trying to save these structures, be authentic with them, tell their stories, many people might question, particularly at the beginning of projects where things are abandoned, decayed, may be unsavable.
Recently, the park was just designated as the developed areas that I talked about, the road corridor, some of that minor and major development that happened in the park, the Paradise Lodge area, the Longmire area. They've designated this part as a National Historic Landscape. And that's because the significant contributing factor is because Mount Rainier is such, from the smallest elements, from our retaining walls, our CCC era retaining walls, to our bridge work, to the lodges and the housing developments, you know, moving gradually in scale, we've maintained the integrity that the early planners had laid out, and it's a significant example of early master planning in the history of the National Park Service for national parks.
Do they truly add to the beauty?
Well, that's an unfair question to ask an architect when you talk about some of our structures at our cultural sites, our national historic sites. Absolutely, at the sites that celebrate great American architecture. The structure is the reason for the park. I think we've gone a long way in the National Park Service to eliminate the artificial division sometimes we had between natural resources and cultural resources, and to see that we really have to manage these sites, whether they were initially set aside as primarily a natural area or primarily a cultural area, that we are finding they have values that are inherent to both.
National parks are quite often how Americans identify their country, whether they realize they're national parks or not. We use them as the symbols of what the United States is, from the Grand Canyon to Independence Hall to the Statue of Liberty. When you ask an American to conjure a physical image of the country as opposed to, say, freedom, you know, a physical image, it often is a national park image, whether they realize it is a national park or not. So I see that context as being pretty important in the values of Americans, of what their country means.
By virtue of what we now understand about preservation and the ecology of the area, we recognize there isn't anything as good or bad in terms of the animal. It's just that you have to protect everything. And it was a little bit of a change, even when I was there, I would hear about them taking a shovel, for example, to pick up a rattlesnake that happened to be on a trail. Now, my inclination was to kill a rattlesnake, and because he would have been one of those bad animals. But you don't find that true today, and even at that time, it was beginning to shift away from the idea that it was a bad to it's an animal that's a part of the ecology of the area. And so the shovel is used to pick up the rattlesnake to put him out someplace where he's going to be kept alive instead of using it to kill the animal.
You know, when you're in the backcountry, in wilderness, where according to the Wilderness Act, you're supposed to have opportunities for solitude, maybe you meet, you know, 40, 50 people along the trail when you're back there. Is that serving the visitor?
What it really amounted to was that the concessioner was pushing for the most people that they could take down the river. I think there were about 17 different operators at one time on the Colorado River. And they were, most of them were taking down people who would go down on oar raft, that is motor rafts. And of course, every one of those people, think it was the greatest experience they'd ever had. But to the person who went down in an oar raft after going down in a motor raft, would say that the oar raft was the greatest experience. That is, the younger people would. And so the Park Service said, well, wait a minute. If we're going to really make the wilderness in, if we're really going to have wilderness in Grand Canyon, then we cannot have motors. And the initial idea was, well, the motors would pollute the water of the Colorado River. And so the idea was, okay, then we'll have a study made. We'll show that there is pollution in the river from the motors. But what it showed was that, by golly, there wasn't any there wasn't that much pollution occurring in the Colorado River because of the motor. It was really a question of whether or not this was a kind of typical use it should be in a national park.
I'll go to the example of Golden Gate National Recreation Area, which has a tremendous legacy of architecture that goes back to the early Presidio days, to Alcatraz, the prison, the very, very compelling places to visit. But it is a terrific natural area as well. Sea life, birds, the last vestiges of natural coastline. And it is the challenge that park managers have now to manage to fulfill both to preserve and protect natural resources as well as cultural resources.
Sort of get a look at what Homestead looks like. That's the prairie restoration that was done starting in 1939. It has a value in itself now because it's the oldest restored prairie in the national park system, and except for a small part at the University of Wisconsin, it's the oldest restored prairie in the United States. And it does give visitors a semblance of what this land looked like before pioneers came. Yet when you go to Homestead now, you get almost no semblance of agriculture or cultivation. What you get is this natural landscape that's been recreated. And true, now tallgrass prairie is rare and it needs protecting. But on the other hand, the visitor, I don't think, is getting the experience at Homestead that the people who created the park intended.
Because you could say this about fishing. Fishing was permitted and is continued to be permitted. But fishing is a form of hunting. And we said, no, you can't hunt the land animal, but you can go out and catch and take the native trout out of the stream. And I think it's only been because you can't see the trout in the stream, where you can see the animal, you can see the elk, you can see the bison. So you can't shoot the bison, you can't shoot the elk, but you can fish and take the native cutthroat trout.
There were those out there that said, well, just the mountain needs to be protected. And Muir came down and said that it's not the ice and the rocks that need to be protected. You know, well, that was fantastic. But it's the trees and the vegetation and the meadows and the subalpine meadows in the park. Those are the areas that need to be protected. And so through Muir's lobbying and others too, the original intent of the park to draw the boundaries around the glaciers was expanded to include some of those beautiful lush meadows that I actually brought a slide of. You can see the mountain and the meadows and the vegetation.
What's your sense about all of the newspaper controversy, if you want to call it controversy, about losing the national parks and the resources because of all the people coming to parks? How do you react to that? Those kind of alarms that are projected out to them through the media?
Well, I think that it's true that there is a lot that the public will miss. It's happening more right now than it did before, but I guess the media and its relationship to the parks was probably brought to the fore initially, for me anyway, in Yellowstone in 1988 when they had the fires in Yellowstone. The media seem to be more concerned with the telling of the destruction of Yellowstone, and yet what it really was all about was the fires are a natural part of the ecology of the forest in Yellowstone. One of the major issues that the Park Service had to face in Yellowstone in 1988 was the fact that bulldozers were not going to be permitted. And you look in here, in these policies, it'll tell you that you do not use bulldozers to control a fire in a national park because of what they're going to do to the land. The fire, in one sense, is natural. That bulldozer is not. The bulldozer can leave something, will be there for years and years and years, tens and maybe even hundreds of years. And the fire, I would judge this, you could go back to Yellowstone today, 9 years later, and probably see some of those trees that are now only 3 and 4 feet high. Well, sure, they're not the same forest that you would see there before, but that's the process of natural evolution in terms of the forest covering the park. Same species? Yes, because Yellowstone is composed of 80% of it, of its forest cover is lodgepole pine.
But every threat to a park resource, by our definition, by the Park Service definition, is a human threat. Because by our definition, if it's a natural process, it's not a threat in most cases. Very rarely do we consider a natural process to be a threat. We consider that to be what we're there for. So you can essentially say all threats to the park are from the public. In some ways, planning is not unique in the parks. All planning has its constraints and has its purposes. I think probably planning in the National Park Service has a lot of good elements and a lot of elements I think could be improved. We tend to have in the past been very focused only on the boundary of the park, particularly if you look at what we used to call master plans up until the 60s, and then general management plans up until not that long ago, last 10, 15 years. If it was anywhere beyond that line, we didn't care, as though nothing was happening beyond that line, as though water wasn't flowing in and air pollution wasn't coming in and buildings weren't being built to change the view and so forth. I think that was not to our best advantage to draw those artificial constructs, because one, it didn't serve the resources well. And second, it implied to the people outside the park that they were little interest to the Park Service. And it marginalized or diminished the value of these local communities. And in essence, these parks depend on the surrounding communities for their existence, because nobody has a greater day-to-day influence on a park than the people who live next to it. And the best plans are the ones where we get people involved at the beginning instead of springing things on them half done, because like it or not, the perception is always been, and it's even stronger now, that we're the quote big federal government here to tell them what to do, and we need to appear as the local federal government here to work with them instead of the big federal government here to tell them what to do.
Mount Rainier is such from the smallest elements, from our retaining walls, our CCC era retaining walls, to our bridge work, to the lodges and the housing developments, moving gradually in scale, we've maintained the integrity that the early planners had laid out, and it's a significant example of early master planning in the history of the National Park Service.
Is the landscape architects start to make recommendations on the retention of facilities in national parks and the development of new facilities. And they start to look at what is the ideal degree and scale of these developments. Well, they looked at the canyon area and they said the area had violated and continued to violate the enabling legislation for the park. And this had occurred to the detriment of the area and the exclusion of thousands of tourists enjoying the area to the greatest possible degree. The concentration of concessionaires' facilities was gradually breaking down the natural conditions so that within a short time, the area would be barren and the scenery would greatly impair.
I mean, moving back a few hundred feet off of the rim and then constructing Canyon Village, to me, was an exercise in, is there such a word as timidity? I really think it didn't have the benefit of what we know now. I'm sure in those days, we talked about it in terms of our planning. We didn't consider resources. We didn't collect the data. There weren't science people involved in planning. It was driven by designers.
In 1972, it was about the time that we were then talking about making an environmental impact statement in one page. One simple page. And anybody who is involved in making an EIS today recognizes that if you're talking about one page, that's only one page out of hundreds and maybe even thousands of pages that will make up that document today.
I think managing by surveys or polls would not be appropriate. But I think it is a matter of listening to what the public wants.
The planners with the Park Service and our own people in Grand Canyon were involved in preparing this plan, which might be several years in its making. And of course, then we had to bring the public in, because the public, after all, we were talking about the public's business, but then have to make a decision before the public had an opportunity to know what was going to be done wasn't the way that it should be done. And what we found, that I suppose we would spend some 5 or 6 years in developing the plan, because we would have public meetings such as this, where we would present the plan to the public. And the public for a long time had the impression, or got the impression from us, that, well, the decision's now made, and you're just doing this as a part of, you might say, the window dressing.
In this view is what happens in 1955. The lodge is removed, the campground is removed, and a new village is established. And I would say that distance is that a half a mile as much as that, Ken?
Yes, at least that.
It's about a half a mile away from the canyon. In the 30s, they had also designated the sides of the canyon to about 100 feet beyond the rim as a sacred area that could not be built upon other than to create an overlook or access to a trail. Well, Canyon Village is realized in 1956-57 as part of a new development program called Vision 66. Conrad Wirth, who had been the head of the State Park Development Program for the Park Service in the 1930s, is now director of the Park Service. He is a landscape architect by training. And he says, as his policy for Vision 66, the most significant scenic, scientific, or historical areas shall be reserved for aesthetic, interpretive, or recreational enjoyment. Other developments, such as accommodations and administrative facilities, shall be restricted and, if necessary, relocated in the less scenic and less vital portions of the park. And he says this is the principle behind the development of the new Canyon Village to replace the intrusive facilities now on the rim of the Yellowstone Canyon. Wirth never recognizes you know, what the landscape architects 20 years before had recommended, although he's doing exactly what they said in terms of removing things from the canyon. But what we have is a whole new ethic of design. We're building for large numbers.
Why? We talked about this. Courage. Who wants to go out and ask the public? Who wants to open those doors, those ugly doors, and invite everybody in to tell us what you think about your national park?
There will be those concessioners. There will be the private money that's involved with the parks. And this is one of the principal things that today you will find as an argument any time that you deal with the government, and that is the money that's involved in the park is going to be the thing that's going to be guiding the principles that that you're going to be faced with making.
The way it was described is whatever we do, we don't want to increase the size of the footprint in parks, meaning the amount of developed land. And we're probably pretty good about doing that. If you see that as your mission, how you're going to carry out the mission, is don't go outside the already impacted area. We're probably pretty good. We don't build many new things outside that area. But we sure as hell reinvest in mistakes.
This is built on the edge overlooking the upper falls of the Grand Canyon, and the architect is Robert C. Reamer, who also constructed Old Faithful Inn, which is still there today. Let me describe what one reporter talked of in terms of this building. Unity without harshness, great size without ostentation, strike the beholder. He felt it had its own individuality. And it surrendered to the vast nobility of the scene in which it was placed. It was complete, natural, and captivating. He felt it was an architectural triumph of singular and striking symmetry with its natural environment. Now, the architect said, "I built it in keeping with the place where it stands. Nobody could improve upon that. To be at discord with the landscape would be almost a crime. To try to improve upon it would be an impertinence." So here we are in 1911, this grand hotel opens, and the reports are, you know, say it rivals the hotels in its amenities of Europe, but it has a modest place within the environment.
It also reminds me of what the Park Service does so well. And that's the business of putting things in context and in a design problem. When we do that, we're very good at not just focusing on discrete parts and pieces of it based on our single specialty, but allowing that design problem to get as large as possible and expand out and consider the approach that people might have to it and their anticipation and how they experience that feature and how it's interpreted in the story that's told. It's really done well.
Well, that job was a close collaboration between architects at the Denver Service Center, landscape designers and architects there, and our interpretive designers at our Harpers Ferry Center in West Virginia.
That must have been quite a challenge to do something as heroic as the actual resource and yet be not domineering or dominating that kind of resource.
I think that probably was the greatest challenge is we had architecture at Mount Rushmore previous to what we have today that was very nondescript. When people would come in and try to classify the architecture, the most often heard term I heard was post office architecture, of 1950s post office architecture. It was oftentimes not the materials of the area. It had the lines and dimension of the late 1950s, early 60s. It was really dated architecture. We believe Mount Rushmore is timeless, and we thought the architecture that surrounded Mount Rushmore should be timeless as well. Therefore, we turned to the more classic lines. And on the next slide, I think we'll show somewhat of the kind of architectural character that we wanted to develop throughout the memorial, in terms of an entranceway or a gateway into the memorial, in terms of the proportion of the columns and the spaces that people would feel good about the space they were, and feel good about the relationship of that kind of architecture to the mountain itself.
Strong interpretive messages designers send with, mm-hmm. with in fact, the things they design and what's built in a park.
Right, at all scales, from large developments to picnic areas to the treatments of that transition from the parking lot into the visitor center, the ceremony that we build as they experience the park.
One representative of the National Parks Association had this to say. To free the rims of the canyon of clutter is a most worthwhile project, but beyond that, we found little to praise. The new concessionaire's buildings are colossal and freak in design. Man here is creating a feature that will compete with the park's natural wonders for public attention. Conspicuous park structures violate the national park policy.
And actually, we have another quote here. René Dubois was a Pulitzer Prize winning biologist and writer, author, and suggests here in this slide that parks are not parks without people. Now, that may be a huge generalization on my part, but certainly that what we encounter in parks and some of the man-made structures and features, that's all right, that's okay, because in fact, we people have all had impact and who visit those parks, and that's part of the story and part of the resources. Any reaction to Renee's feelings on that?
Well, yes. I think one of the real challenges of the next millennium for parks is simply America and Americans love their parks perhaps to death. And as a professional architect and landscape architects are going to have to face those challenges of designing facilities and installing facilities that allow access to our parks with all of the amenities the American public have come to expect: parking lots, restrooms, places to eat, places to explore, without destroying those places. And so the nature of those facilities, how those facilities interact with transportation systems, are going to be tremendous problems for us. As those very places we want to protect and save, the act of saving them transforms them. And both for the natural processes and, as we talked earlier, with very similar with our cultural properties, those sorts of things we do to make it easier to go into a building or easier to park or a more accessible walkway oftentimes can not have the results we immediately think they're going to have, and may in fact diminish the resource.
So the standards really help with that balancing act of maintaining historic integrity, if that exists in the roadway corridor, preserving natural resources, safety, and accommodating various kinds of visitors in use, which is all fairly complex to plug all those in as design factors.
That's right, and it's like the park road standards. We have cultural resource standards, and we have natural resource standards, filling in wetlands. So it helps to have something to go from whenever you're doing a design. You need to know your limitations. If you don't know what your limitations are, you have a tendency to back up and redesign. So if you've got a palette of givens when you start the design, it really helps you in getting the design that more satisfies everybody that's got input into it. Some of these parkways were built in the 30s and 40s and 50s. that they're on the National Register too, and it's our goal to keep them the characteristic of that road the same as it was when they first built it. And if they used stone walls when they first built the parkway, there'll always be stone walls there for barriers.
In the Park Service, we think sometimes the only message to get is you can get across is if you put up a sign or if you outright tell someone. But designing of a circulation system in a developed area, or you know the developed area itself, that sends a message without sending a message.
In this picture, actually, this is the Ahwahnee Hotel in Yosemite Valley, and it strikes you with that towering granite wall there that it looks appropriate, and it's served the people for years. The raging debate usually revolves around its use and appropriate use within that structure, and how elite should. The elitist kind of attitude of who can afford to go to the Ahwahnee and who would be relegated to stay in the campground, and who has priority for accommodations there. So it's interesting, a structure that probably gets less comment in terms of its architectural appropriateness, more on its use, its continued use.
Well, speaking as a historical architect, I certainly don't see the Ahwahnee as a controversial structure. It's a legitimate historic structure. It is recognized as such, has some very pioneering aspects of the use of concrete to build it, to replicate natural materials.
The vision and the realization of the vision is not just Dan Wenk. It's a lot of people. It's the staff. It's the American public who participated in the process. It's our friends group who stepped up to fund the process. And it's also, I would also tell you that it's our detractors when we started the project. The detractors, I think, had a very positive influence on the final outcome in terms of they did cause us to question and to relook at some things that we did. And because of those questions, I think it became a better project. Did we do exactly the right thing? Certainly at the time when we were designing the facilities, I think we often, whether it be the National Park Service or the architects and engineers, the professional consultants that we hired, I think we often stepped back and said, you know, what kind of time frame are we designing here for? You know, what will this accomplish? Are we doing the right thing? What else should we have done? And I'm not saying that's unhealthy. I think it has to happen.
This happens to be a rendition, a model of a small structure from Nez Perce National Historic Park in Idaho. And interestingly enough, the Park Service, with all good intention, again, with our architects, tried to design something that we thought was reflective of Native American culture and design. And I would have to inform you that no sooner were these structures built than they were burned to the ground. Is that unusual, an unusual occurrence?
I think that's a little unusual in terms of an immediate reaction. We talked earlier about appropriate structures in authentic places, and that is a great responsibility that a designer has to impose upon themselves. And the policies require, in the planning stages, a lot of public input and review. But ultimately, you get to a point where you practice the art of architecture or landscape architecture and come up with your work. And sometimes it's best, perhaps, like this example, it should have never been built.
There seems to be a wide spectrum of from just stabilizing a historic structure and someone deciding that's all we're going to spend versus going to an elaborate kind of recreation.
Well, that certainly is a challenge for the Park Service now. And the people that deal with our existing budgets and our existing needs of all the structures we have is that many individuals will go to a site such as Springfield, Illinois, which is a wonderful scene, terrific stories told about President Lincoln, and perhaps have that same expectation for another site in another state, and their legislatures, legislators may also have that same expectation. We want to do something similar. And these things all involve a lot of capital investment.
$56 million is our total project. We were successful in getting, from National Park Service appropriation, we got $350,000 to do the initial plan. Beyond that, in terms of federal dollars, we were successful in qualifying for some from ICE-T funds, Intermodal Surface Transportation Enhancement Act funds from the Department of Transportation to help relocate our road and to build a trail that would get people in closer contact with the mountain. So that $56 million, $3 million approximately, is federal funds, and $53 million is private funds.
That's one of the issues that's come up on that project is when we modernize that road in the park, we're going to be undergoing that three-year construction project within the next year, is issues of design that landscape architects and the Park Service need to deal with. Is this is a tiny, narrow little road corridor, and we have safety standards now, and that are federal standards that we need to consider. But we also don't want to lose the integrity of the parkway and having vegetation right up next to the road and that feel that you get, that you know when you're in a national park, you know, that sense. And those are the qualities that we don't want to lose. And so those are issues that need to be resolved.
Olmsted Jr. was part of an expert committee for Yosemite National Park in the late 20s. And he gave them a lot of wisdom because they were having real problems accommodating all the visitors at that time. They had a real crisis in Yosemite at that time. And people would, you know, say, well, what can you do here? He had this nibble principle, you know, that little by little you nibble away the kind of the integrity of this natural place. But he sort of said, you know, this place was created over thousands and thousands of years in geological time. And it's going to stand up. And all these man-made things are going to fall apart. And that no matter what we put here now, ultimately, it's the valley with its granite walls that it's going to stay.
Because I think the fact that you had 30, 40, 50 people, depending on what point of the convention it was, who sometimes didn't like each other and didn't trust each other managing to write the Constitution is a more interesting story, to think that you had 50 people in the room who loved each other, all working with divine inspiration, creating this document.
Is it from a value set that says, You can't have the experience you remember having because of all the people next to you when you're there?
Yes, it does.
And does it say that everyone now should have the experience you had years ago?
But to get them to accept what I had years ago, they have to understand why it is, and they have to be made to see it the same way that I see it. And I think that's the rub when it comes to interpretation. We've gotten away from the interpretation that tells us what the animal is, the identification of the animal. We have to look at it more in terms of where does that animal fit in the total ecology. Okay, then when I say that I want the same kind of experience I had in 1947, or that I would get today, I want to be able to have my grandkids to have that experience.
I think that's one of the exciting things about trying to deal with the visitors at Mount Rushmore, is that you're dealing with their life histories. You know, their you know, their frame of reference for what America means. Immigrants to this country. Mount Rushmore has a, you know, they come up. They have naturalization services at Mount Rushmore every few years to naturalize new American citizens. I mean, they come to Mount Rushmore and they're almost overwhelmed. It's amazing when something is fought for, whether it be through a battle on a field someplace, and whether it be a foreign country or our country, or whether it's fought for by learning about our country because you want to become a citizen, the meaning is different.
Unfortunately, the thing that got cut more times than not was the interpretation, not the maintenance or not the ranger, because the ranger was there to protect the public. The maintenance was there to make sure that you had water and sewer systems were operating and things of that kind. And so I was looked upon at interpretation in one sense was kind of you might say it was the frosting to the cake. But yet we would always say to the public, oh no, it's not the frosting to the cake, it's why we're here. It's important for us to communicate to you that this is what this area is all about, this is why it's important. This is why that rattlesnake is important. That's why the elk is important, but that's also why the wolf is important today. But when it came to the end of the year or the beginning of a year when you had to work on your budget, you didn't look at interpretation in quite the same way.
Well, that's interesting because it's generally, I think, true. It has been true that when surveys and ratings are done of the general public in terms of their attitude about government agencies, the National Park Service seems to always be at the top of that list, or second, I think usually at the top of the list, and rated by the public in terms of their experience. And of course, interpreters are the Park Service's first line contact with the public.
When I first started working on park roads, I didn't think that from a landscape architect's standpoint that I would have much input. Well, I was very wrong. When people come to a park, their first experience is from their car and on the road to get to the park. It's like when you meet somebody. The first impression is very important. Well, it's no different in a park. We want that first impression to be a good one. And to make it a good one, we've got to make it a special place that they feel safe in, that they like seeing, that they feel comfortable in, and that they look forward to where they're going. That first impression is gets them excited.
I think that that's part of that, what I was saying earlier, the difference between the way you can't look at a park like you used to anymore. I don't think the public critiques exhibits the way we do. That is, we look at it and say, oh, this is 30 years old, it's 40 years old, that design style isn't popular anymore. We need more natural elements, less chrome, you know, whatever it is, because we look at the design element of the exhibit. I think the public looks at the quality of the exhibit, not whether or not they think it's the most up-to-date, modern, state-of-the-art design. They look and see whether the pictures look old, whether or not it looks neglected, whether or not the information is accurate anymore, whether or not the stuff is fading or peeling, whether or not it tells a story that relates to them. People carry some of these myths so intrinsically that it's difficult to dispel them in a single site visit. Also, you don't necessarily want to, your job isn't to take people in and tell them everything they know is wrong. Because, you know, the Liberty Bell was not cracked on the 4th of July. The Declaration of Independence was not signed on the 4th of July. Lincoln did not write the Gettysburg Address on the back of an envelope. A lot of the stuff people have heard, they believe to be true, is not at all true. But because people have heard this so long, and we're talking about adults who might have heard it for 30 years from people they respected, teachers or their parents or something, you have to be careful in how you approach it. Because people are still on vacation. They're there to have fun.
Archaeologists blocking the dang trail. I can't get on this trail because they got this sucker dug up. Archaeologists are great. If you ever encounter archaeologists, they're come of two schools. One, talkative, and two, not talkative. And if you get one talking, they can't shut up. Man, they're going to show you everything that they found in that hole.
This is a homestead in Custer County, Nebraska in 1886. You can see a lot of elements here. For one thing, it's a sod house. People expect to find a sod house at homestead, and sod houses didn't occur where the park is because there was timber. And nobody was going to build a house out of sod when you had timber. But when you got farther west and there wasn't any timber, you had to build out of sod. But look at the way this family's posed for this picture. First of all the family members are out there. They're in their best clothes. They also want to show off what livestock they own, their horses and their cattle, because that's wealth. They also have this watermelon here to show that they're able to produce something. You know, that grew that on their land. They are prosperous. They're producing food. So this photograph tells you a lot about how this family felt to be a homesteader.
They drove into the parking lot. There was no cars there, and they didn't know what to do. They went into the visitor center. The door was unlocked. They went in the visitor center, but there was nobody there. And so they started looking around, feeling very uncomfortable about being there without anybody else being there. And then pretty soon the ranger came from the back and you know, welcomed them there and told them about they had an opportunity to visit the museum area or look at the AV program or go out and explore the prairie. So once they found out those things, they were much more comfortable. So visitor centers are very, very important in helping people acclimate to a park, understand why they're there.
This is a piece of work that I know you're familiar with.
Franklin Court in Philadelphia, designed by Ken Venturi. Yeah, very well-known site. And a very popular Independence National Historic Site, and I think was a very appropriate solution to giving the visitor information about a building that was missing. And again, I think that structure has now begun to stand that test of time. I don't think we regret having erected it. I think it is very clear to the visitor what it represents without incurring the cost of a reconstruction, and a reconstruction that we probably knew very little about enough of the detail to rebuild that building without vast amounts of conjecture. And I think the American public deserves better than conjecture from the National Park Service. They deserve authentic places and authentic experiences, the best that we can deliver.
I've heard this is a rumor on the street here that the Park Service may be considering actually turning over many of their interpretive activities, that first line contact with the public, and also that educational kind of responsibility we've always associated with park employees, Park Service employees, to concessionaires, and perhaps even to the point that they then, as they would need to charge a fee, so a visitor to a park might find they not only have to choose what activity they're going to participate in, but which activity they are willing to pay for. Is that really on the horizon?
I can't answer that question, but to the first part of your question, I would say there are it is a partnership, but there is a senior partner and a junior partner. You know, I believe that there's an important relationship there in terms of the concessioner is there, in the case of multiple, doing those things that we've asked them to do and doing them at a standard that we prescribe that they do them at.
In my mind, a t-shirt, say, can be very interpretive. This bison might be the one thing that your child remembers, but because they have this bison, they remember being at Mount Rushmore and seeing those faces and learning about those four presidents and learning about our country's history. So this may trigger that. So in that respect, it is an interpretive device.
It might trigger a future conversation as much as the card would.
Exactly, yeah. Although in itself, it's not interpretive.
In 1927, the first resident landscape architect, Ernest Davidson, is assigned to the park. And he takes a look at what's there. And this is a sketch of Artist Point. It's the existing conditions with the wooden steps and landings, a proposed overlook to take in the view. And he was working closely with the natural history ranger who was interested in developing an interpretive program to explain the geology of the canyon to the public. And you see the road is already coming in pretty close to the edge of the canyon. Davidson was really struck by all this, and he did make the proposal that as these timber constructions broke down, they should be replaced by stone with flagstone flooring, stone walls with an undulating line, using native stones from the environment, of big boulders, so that they would blend into the natural setting, and so that they would be inconspicuous, and basically they would disappear because they would have the same irregular character of the surrounding scenery.
I think the issues are almost always more complex than the average person realizes. Not because they don't want to, it's just that they have a thousand other things in their life and they're not going to be park professionals. I think the recent controversy over snowmobiles and Voyagers and shooting of bison at Yellowstone are great examples of two fairly complex issues with a lot of local fervor that the national audience hears snippets but doesn't quite grasp the full concept. They never will watching it on evening news. They're much too complex an issue to understand in 2 minutes.
Who'd be hanging around a toilet with listening to your Walkman? Anyway, this is an Alcatraz prison out in the San Francisco harbor. Everyone's seen the movie The Rock, or the one Escape from Alcatraz with Burt Lancaster when Ken was a kid. Anyway, that's a National Park Service site, part of Golden Gate National Park. And the main interpretation in there, they have exhibits and all that, but the coolest part of the interpretation is you rent the headsets and the guided tour is provided by whoever this is, Lieutenant Maurice Ordway, Captain Philip Bergen, Jim Quinlan, Alcatraz prisoner number 586, or Leon Whitey Thompson, prisoner number 1465. And those guys gave you the tour of Alcatraz. Can you imagine the stories they could tell?
Our population is made up of, 50% women. And also, as a nation, we're changing ethnically. Different groups are coming in and visiting our parks. It's not traditionally, the white male designer designing for upper middle class, white people coming to parks. And we have Asian and international visitors and African American and Hispanic. And, we have all sorts of visitors coming to our park. And so our park staffs need to reflect that and reflect, those cultural values to understand their values and park values and joining those together and productively and sharing, park values wherever you're at, whether it's an urban park or a wilderness park or a historical park. That's important because National Park Service history is based on public support. The reason we have parks is because we've been able to build that support with the public to protect these areas, and we need to continue that with the changing demographics.
Would you say that your messages would be a message driven by an organizational imperative?
Yes.
It's the Park Service's view about the significance through their interpretation of the Act of Congress establishing that park. But it's the Park Service saying, this is what's important here, and this is what you should take away from this place, this sort of understanding. And I just wondered how that, how you think that organizational imperative, that organizational message, the story you're telling, rings with a diverse visitor.
Well, absolutely, we have been told in our legislation what we're there for. You know, we're there to preserve that great piece of sculpture, and we're also told, you know, that we need to provide for its use and for the educational and interpretive purposes. At Mount Rushmore, I think different than a lot of other places, people take away from Mount Rushmore in many ways what they bring to Mount Rushmore.
The resource probably could be defined at Homestead as stories, the stories of people and their lives. And we're not protecting that resource because we're not really interpreting to the fullest extent possible those stories.
Waysides are, we call them rangers on a stick sometimes, because that ranger right there, he's there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, rain or shine. You don't have to buy him a uniform, and he tells you everything you need to know about that building or that thing. Waysides are great tools, great interpretive tools, if they're done right. They do a lousy job of trying to convey an idea. They interpret something very physical, something that's directly in front of them.
But we'd always say, oh, it's very important for us to tell a visitor, to explain to them what the story is here. Well, you'd say then, it's very important today, and it is important today. But when you are short on money, and if your budget gets cut, what's the first thing that they would cut out? Unfortunately, the thing that got cut more times than not was the interpretation, not the maintenance or not the ranger, because the ranger was there to protect the public. The maintenance was there to make sure that you had water and sewer systems were operating and things of that kind. And so I was looked upon at interpretation in one sense was kind of a, well, you might say it was the frosting to the cake. But yet we would always say to the public, oh no, it's not the frosting on the cake, it's why we're here. It's important for us to communicate to you that this is what this area is all about. This is why it's important.
I have a final question for you. And that is, thinking back to all your experiences as an employee of the National Park Service, and dealing with roads and visitors and managing resources and politics, policy standards, if you could change something for the benefit of the general public and their experience with parks and meeting the mission, what would you change? What would you think would make a huge difference?
The one policy that I would change is a policy that relates to reservations. I really feel that we have to put a limitation on the number of people that can go to an area. And therefore it means that I would have to plan in advance when I'm going to go to that park. It might mean even the parks would have to say that I will be allowed to go to Yellowstone only once in my lifetime.
So there's historically a congressional resistance to a reservation mm-hmm. system that would only allow me to go once in my lifetime. And then there's the general public. I mean, it's the Buick, it's the Chevrolet, it's the freedom of the open road, it's the ethic of packing my family up for my annual trip and the freedom to just stop where I want to because I see that arrowhead and let's go in there for the day. You're talking about taking that away.
That's right.
And what happens to the support of the public? Will the public let you do something like
no,
that?
No, they won't let you do it today, but I think that's why the Park Service has to have a planned program that maybe you don't start it, you cannot start it out at one in one fell swoop. You may have to start out initially, maybe it goes in only into effect in Yosemite. Maybe it goes only into effect in Yellowstone. There are still a large number of areas, and they're going to continue to be for a long, long time, and maybe forever, There will be certain areas that you won't have a limitation on the number of people.
We get support for change in the Park Service from a few people, and I think that has a negative impact. Normally when we do planning and design and construction, it takes a long period of time to do that. And because it takes a long time, we make some changes along the way. And I think those changes are always good. And that once we actually build something, for the most part, I think we build something that's special and fits in the National Park Service. I mean, there's exceptions, but for the most part, we really do a good job as a whole. But it's when we get told to do something in a quick manner because of somebody's whim. I think that if I could change anything, it would take those whims away from the political types. The only thing I can think of to change is to have more interaction and maybe not be so quick to respond when we're in the news and it's negative news. I think that we need to have more public involvement. And unfortunately, public involvement, the people that we normally get to public meetings are the people that are very outspoken and have one interest at heart. We normally don't get people that are for what we're doing. We normally get people that are against what we're doing.
A reservation system and setting use limits in the park, not only in the wilderness, but in the front country as well. In the developed areas, you know, there's only so much development that the park can take care of, the park can handle. And I would have to agree that use limits and a reservation system and addressing the issue of carrying capacities, that's what needs to be done. The permit system and a reservation system, they're just tools. Education is what is most effective. You know, the permit is just a way to manage that, but the education system is what, education process of people, that's what's most effective.
Our mission is grounded in law. Oftentimes we take that law and we write regulation and policy, which are right at the time, but then we live with those regulations and policies beyond the time that they have a useful life. Regulations are not law. Policies are not law. But oftentimes we treat them as if they're law. If I could do anything, I think what I would do is I would say, we need to go back to the basic of what does that law say. If we were writing the regulation or the regulation first for that law, would we write it the same way we have it today? And I don't think we would. We wouldn't write it that way in terms of concession policy. We wouldn't write it that way in terms of some of the cultural preservation, natural resource preservation. I think we've become stewards of our regulation in some cases instead of stewards of our law.
We, in this country, have a policy says that we will preserve and protect things, and we mean it forever and ever. And we don't accept the fact very well in our parks that some resources perhaps are transitory, they are going to decay and molder, there's going to be this terrific interaction of vegetation with decay. I find that process personally very mysterious. I think it tells us a lot about ourselves, but we don't seem to address that well. We either are going to preserve something or we knock it down. It's dangerous, it presents safety problems.
I guess if I could change anything though, I would change the attitude of park managers and park employees to be more user-friendly, more visitor-oriented. And we have a lot of people that look as visitors as a problem. If the people get on our side, that they're going to be fighting for our parks more than we're fighting for our parks.
there's a lot good in what we do. But I also think that, like any organization, organizations tend to protect themselves over time. And when you get to the point where you're running the organization instead of what the organization is supposed to do, you have a problem. The National Park Service wasn't created to run the National Park Service. And organizations tend to do that after a while. They're so enamored with protecting themselves instead of what they do that it becomes dangerous. Look at our bureaucracy and the way we do things and say, you know, maybe change is the enemy of tradition, but also change is the birth of tradition. What is it that's taking up all of our time that's changed? And some of it is probably our own processes and bureaucracy.
The basis for your argument really stems from the Organic Act that established the National Park Service and its mission, its mandate, really to leave those resources unimpaired for future generations.
You know, and what is unimpaired?
And you're defining that and saying, by defining a point in time and saying then we're also going to further control or manage through controls how many people go. So the strength of your beliefs is founded in the original beliefs of the founding fathers for the National Park Service.
That's right.
From their mission statement.
Right.